Colossal blue stones like these were used in the construction of one of Britain's most popular and much-loved Neolithic monuments. Now, you may be able to guess which ancient monument I'm referring to, but you might be surprised to learn where I am. And I'll reveal more about my whereabouts in just a few moments. Today, our house hunt will be taking us from east to west and far-flung places.
It's the Costa del Wales here.
But we end up heading in exactly the right direction.
Which one do you think that might be?
That one.
No, this one.
We're rubbish.
Today, I'm in Pembrokeshire, in the far western corner of Wales, at the rocky outcrop of Craig Rosavellin in the Priscilly Hills, where you'll find these blue stones, the likes of which were used in the construction of the inner circle of Stonehenge in Wiltshire. Now, geologists have long suggested that those stones came from this very site. But what they're less sure about is exactly how they made that 180-mile journey to get there. Did they go overland, perhaps via sea? Or maybe they were carried there via a glacier. Now, the mystery of these stones and how they got all the way to Salisbury Plain from here, perhaps it will never be solved. But what isn't up for debate is the glorious beauty that this largely unspoilt and remote county has to offer. Lying in the southwest of Wales, Pembrokeshire is renowned for its extensive coastline and shares borders with Carmarthenshire and Ceredigion. Covering over 600 square miles, the rugged landscape is peppered with fortifications, including the majestic Pembroke Castle that dates back to 1093. Throw forward several hundred years and it was the attractive coastal town in Tenby that was putting this part of the country on the map. Victorian holidaymakers came here pursuing the health benefits of fresh air and bathing in seawater. Built into the cliff face near Bosherston is a tiny 13th century chapel. Measuring just 18 by 12 feet, it marks the home of the 6th century hermit, St Govan. Pembrokeshire's beguiling heritage and dramatic natural coastline make it a tempting proposition not just for visitors, but for those looking for a long-term rural adventure. Although property prices across West Wales have gone up around 10% over the past 5 years, this region still offers relative value for money. The average price of a detached house across the three counties that make up West Wales comes in at just over £212,000. That's a very welcome £120,000 below the UK figure. And today's buyers are prepared to go the distance in order to take advantage of this value for money, as they have big plans for their move here. Newly qualified social worker Miranda and recently retired fireman David from the town of Broadstairs in Kent have their sights firmly set on a country move, having taken a long time getting together.
We met each other probably around about 2000, I think.
Yeah, it was.
We started actually seeing each other in 2014, so it was 14 years of getting to know each other.
I always had really strong feelings for you. When the opportunity came, it was too good one not to miss, really.
And I said yes, because I thought, I'm not letting him go this time.
They took decisive action and wasted no time getting married just 18 months later. David was quick to introduce Miranda to one of his favourite places, Pembrokeshire.
I've been to that part of the world quite a few times on holiday and you just fell in love with the area, didn't you?
Yeah. There was a particular house just across from where we were staying and I completely fell in love with it. Dave said, we'll put a note through the door then and we'll see if we can buy that one. That kind of sowed the seed and then we thought, oh, you could, maybe you could have a little campsite if you had this, and that kind of, our dreams evolved from that sort of starting point.
Since that light bulb moment, Miranda and David have developed plans for an exciting business venture.
As well as having a home for ourselves, we'd ideally like a couple of rental cottages, maybe a small campsite with a dozen or so pictures.
Glamping.
We'd like to become a little bit more self-sufficient.
Somewhere with a polytunnel would be a bonus.
We also like the idea of growing our own vegetables. We've got chickens at the moment, so we'll have some more chicks.
But it's not just chickens that will be coming along for the ride.
I shall be taking with me my beloved horse, Rufus, and then we've got the three dogs between us. We've got two Springer Spaniels and then a working cocker. Actually hasn't ever done any work in his life. When we move, it will be so lovely to have my horse effectively in the back garden, peer through the curtains and check that he's okay.
Along with hosting camping guests and looking after a menagerie of pets and poultry, they have other adventurous aspirations.
I'm already a diver and you'd like to get into diving, mm-hmm. So West Wales has got some lovely diving.
Yeah.
The water's really lovely.
I'm hoping that we'll have a bit of freedom to plan our days as we want to, in our own sort of diary, as it were, rather than not having other people telling us what to do.
I don't want to get too old age and think, oh, I wish I'd not tried that. So we're going to grab the bull by the horns and give it a go.
Our house hunters have enjoyed holidaying in the area surrounding Britain's smallest city, St David's, in Pembrokeshire. But to ensure we uncover the best properties on the market, they're willing to extend their search to take in all of West Wales, including Ceredigion and Carmarthenshire. I'm meeting up with them to hear more about their grand business ambitions. Not a bad start to the day, is it?
Stunning.
Now, this relocation for you, it's obviously for yourselves all about getting to enjoy this beautiful part of West Wales, but tapping into the fact that other people want to enjoy it as well. This is hospitality.
Absolutely, yeah. We want to give people a fantastic opportunity to come on holiday, whether we've got holiday lets or gîtes or...
Glamping.
Have you ever been involved in hospitality before?
Nope.
Never.
Well, not from the giving end, from the receiving end.
OK. A lot of people are keen on doing this when they move to the countryside, but it can be hard work.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, and we are aware of that, but we're not going to be providing them with breakfast or anything.
And we're not afraid of hard work. We're used to early mornings and getting on with things, aren't we? We like to fill up our days with things anyway, so...
OK, there's the business element. There's also a requirement for land and quite a bit of it. Because you've got a horse
with a horse.
Dog's name.
Everyone says that.
Because he has, it's called Rufus.
Rufus,
isn't it?
Yeah, so he'll be coming to stay with us as well, not leaving him behind. And he'll need some friends.
Yeah.
So maybe.
What do you mean he's going to. You're going to buy more horses?
I'm not allowed to buy more horses. Once Dave realised how long they live,
I
wasn't allowed to buy any more.
40 years. Well, I think we'll provide livery for local people or people who won't bring their horses on holiday, perhaps.
Yeah.
So stables would be ideal.
Okay, so minimum land requirement.
Maybe 8 acres.
8 acres,
yeah.
Okay. We've not yet spoken about the most important part of the jigsaw, and that's the house itself. What does the house look like in your eye?
As old as possible, as far as I'm concerned, with as much character as possible. Plenty of open fires or wood burners.
Yeah, definitely.
Something like that.
It's got to have loads of character.
You said that straight away. Character, old, and with the age. Also comes maintenance.
Yes, that doesn't faze us at all, really.
No.
Okay.
A big party kitchen diner would be good. We've kind of got this idea of lots of people coming for Christmas, so a nice space for a big long table at Christmas would be great.
How many bedrooms are we talking?
Minimum of 3.
Let's talk budget, because we're not looking for a 2 up, 2 down, are we?
No.
If we want to buy it outright and be mortgage-free, we've got a maximum of about £650,000.
Well, I've got 3 very interesting properties lined up for you. All will give you different aspects of what you said you're after. Maybe one of them will give you a lot. You ready to go?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Fantastic. Thank you.
With the aim of shedding their mortgage commitments, Miranda and David's preferred budget is £650,000. But they would nudge a bit higher for the perfect property. They would like a traditional Welsh farmhouse with 3 bedrooms and holiday let potential. Ideally around 8 acres for a luxury campsite and space for Miranda's horse, Rufus. We'll be exploring 3 very different country homes, which aim to give our ambitious couple lots to consider. But they won't know the cost of each until after the viewings. Last will be our mystery house, which is set to push them to think even bigger than they ever bargained for. So this move to the countryside of yours, this big escape, what do you want to do?
I want to really get into brewing my own beer. We'd like an on-site brewery, hence the reason why we'd like some outbuildings that we convert.
I was going to say, if you want an on-site brewery, I'm turning the car right around, because I've not seen any of those in my property searches. You'll have to build your own, my friend.
Yes, I think that's what it is. But we'll start out by buying the beer in, you know, a micro pub, you know.
What do you mean? You'd like to have a little microbrewery on site and then invite people to come and consume it and pay for it on site?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
You're going at this, aren't you? I mean,
we're living the dream.
You are living the dream. Or you're living the nightmare.
To kickstart our Welsh property hunt, we're heading to the village of Solva on the Pembrokeshire coast. Back in the medieval period, the village's location on the north side of St Bride's Bay made it a key point for trading and a centre for lime burning. A collection of lime kiln remains are still preserved along the harbour. Fast forward to the modern day, and the village is a haven for visitors exploring the Pembrokeshire National Park or taking in the far-reaching views from the nearby Coast Path. Less than 2 miles away is our property. Sat on the pilgrim's route to St David's, it's in a prime position to tap into the tourist trade, ripe for a pair of house hunters with big holiday-let dreams.
Right then, you are going to be looking around everything in front of you.
Oh, wow.
Wow. This is beautiful. What a stunning looking property.
But what a spot as well. You would like to think there's plenty of punters that would like to come and stay.
Yeah, yes, definitely.
And they can and do stay here. This is a home and a holiday let.
Oh, even better.
But I'm going to show you around this part.
OK.
The Victorian farmhouse features two separate dwellings, both of which are currently let as holiday homes. On one side is the original farmhouse, dating back to the 1860s. This part is smaller and spread over 2 floors, which I would think could be Miranda and David's living quarters. The adjoining barn, originally the milking shed, is mostly laid out over 1 level and would make an ideal holiday rental. With business at the forefront of our minds, we're starting in the former barn's living room.
Just want to step there, Miranda, when you come down.
Okay, thank you. Oh,
this is lovely.
How nice is this?
Yeah. I love all the exposed beams and the exposed brickwork. Yeah. And obviously the fire is so welcoming.
You hear it, you feel it, you smell it. As soon as you walk into a home like this, it's part of that.
Brings it to life, doesn't
it?
Yeah,
I think so.
Well, the rooms are really nice size. Sometimes when they've converted old buildings, you get too much height with the ceilings.
Yeah.
But it's a really good feel.
Through that little door there is a spare bedroom, but I want to show you the kitchen, which is decent as well.
Oh, good.
Okay, thank you.
Now, party kitchen. I think you said you wanted a big kitchen.
That's lovely. That's really nice.
That table's big enough for when we
have... That's quite big, isn't it? Yeah.
I flipping hope so.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And it's nice and airy.
Yeah, it's
well.
Really light. I really like it.
Let's go and take a look at one of the bedrooms and then we'll get outside, all right?
OK.
Just squeeze through.
Lovely.
Here.
Thank you.
Mind your step.
Thank you.
Hopefully our couple are already picturing themselves playing host to friends and family in here. In terms of bedroom space, this barn provides them with 5 in total. A double, currently with 2 single beds, lies upstairs from the living room. And the remaining bedrooms are all down on the ground floor. One benefits from its own entrance, giving this property even greater holiday-let credentials. All the bedrooms share similar character features throughout, including exposed stonework and beams. And 2 come with useful en-suites. There's also a shower room with underfloor heating.
Now, this is the biggest of the bedrooms in this side of the property.
Yeah, it's really nice. Nice and light, isn't it?
You've got lots of options as regards to bedroom space for you or guests. It would probably take a bit of a while to get your head around how you would use it.
Sometimes you need to live in a place for a little while, don't you? You might switch things around once you're in there.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You might just say, oh, we'll live in the south wing for a couple of minutes.
I like the sound of that.
David and Miranda could make this converted milk barn home, or they could opt for the white-rendered farmhouse next door if cosier proportions take their fancy. Although smaller, there's a galley kitchen, breakfast room and 3 bedrooms. One is downstairs and the other 2 up on the first floor, including a master with ensuite next to a cosy den. The current owners have renovated this house with great care and in the process uncovered a wealth of features. In the sitting room, they found a huge inglenook fireplace, which now creates a great focal point. Heading outside, we reveal the full scope of what's on offer, with lots of potential for horses.
Well, you can see there's lots to get involved with out here. You have got this paddock here.
Right.
Including that pond. That pond is spring-fed. And the field beyond. All in all, 7.8 acres.
Yeah, okay.
I think this property gives you everything. How would you price it?
I'm not really sure, but I'm going to go for around £600,000.
I think maybe a little bit more, maybe 625.
This place is on the market for offers around £649,950.
Right. Okay.
So why don't you have a good scoot around it? Work out in your minds which of the properties you'd like to live in full time. That's the first question, isn't it?
Yeah, I think I know which one I want.
Okay. Well, go on. Have
Thank
a look.
You.
Catch
Thank
you a bit.
On the market just shy of £650,000, our first property comprises a 19th-century farmhouse with three bedrooms and an adjoining five-bedroom barn conversion. It offers ample scope with an up-and-running holiday let and comes with almost 8 acres of land plus stabling.
Oh, lovely fireplace. It's nice and cosy
nice.
In here.
And nice views, look at that for views, that vista out there.
My favourite of the properties as it's set up now is the smaller of the two. I think it's just a little more farmhousey and cottagey.
With regards to the character of the properties, you can ask for more, really. Lovely oak beams everywhere and wonky doors.
My only reservation, really, is the land. I kind of would have liked a little bit more shelter for my horse.
When we see the right property for the first time, I think we'll know straight away. I'm not 100% convinced that this is right for us.
It's a bit of a buy one, you get one free house, isn't it? Which one do you think you'd live in full time?
This one.
Oh, right. Small and cosy, and then a moneymaker next door.
That's exactly it.
Good thinking. Let's keep going, shall we?
Thank you.
Pembrokeshire takes in 260 miles of protected coast, with more than 50 fantastic beaches and a coastal path that was the first national trail in Wales. Up in the northwest of the county, Aberaethe is a particularly dramatic beach, made up of dark sand formed from grey slate. In a sheltered spot, it's a popular place for coast-steering thrill-seekers to explore the shore through swimming, climbing and jumping. David is keen to give it a go, but first they're meeting Cleopatra Brown of Celtic Quest Coast-Steering to learn about the local conservation efforts.
What a great place to have a business. How long have you been down here?
I've been in Pembrokeshire for about 25 years now.
Well, we're here to do some course steering. When can we get the wetsuits on?
Well, what we'd like to do first, if you don't mind, we'd like to do a two-minute beach clean. I try to introduce all our visitors to just looking after the coast and keeping it as stunning as we can. We've had a quick scooch already and found all sorts of bits of plastic.
Oh, wow. Oh my word. And what kind of effect does that have on the marine life?
Oh, it's shocking. They're going to take years and years and years to break down, and then the marine life and the wildlife could end up eating it, they could get tangled up in it. Just not good stuff at all. So if you take it to the beach, take it away, and take a little bit extra with you.
Oh, fantastic.
OK, let's go.
Cleopatra is raising awareness of an important issue, as litter levels on Welsh beaches are reported to have increased by 51% in the last decade. As well as this more local initiative, the Marine Conservation Society organises an annual litter pick on a national scale in places right across the UK. In 2016, almost 6,000 volunteers joined in, collectively picking up over 200,000 pieces of rubbish. After doing their bit, it's time to hit the cliffs.
So here we are, folks, Aberaethe Blue Lagoon.
Wow, look at it.
Crikey.
It looks high. Yeah, I'm sure it'll be fine.
I think that's too high for me, so I'm going to stay here and watch you, babe.
Okay, honey.
Good luck. Have
I'll
a
see
nice
you soon.
Time.
Let's do it.
See
Let's
you later.
Aberaethe Blue Lagoon was once a working slate quarry. In the 19th century, this was one of Wales's most significant industries. When the quarry closed just over 100 years ago, local fishermen created the lagoon by breaching the outer wall to provide shelter for their boats. And it's now the perfect place to coast steer from.
Nicely done, sir.
Thank you.
David is joining a group of experienced coast steerers at the lagoon, which plunges down to 20 metres at its deepest. But depths may vary, so it's crucial that you have an accredited expert on hand for guidance.
So here we are.
What is it you love about coast steering?
Just everything. Sharing new guys' adventures and just being out there on that raw Pembrokeshire coast. It's just fantastic.
Can't wait to give it a go. Can we get in there?
Let's get in there. Come on up.
There's no getting around the fact that cliff jumping is dangerous. Even jumping from just 10 metres will see you hitting the water at nearly 35 kilometres an hour. Cleopatra trains a novice like David by starting off lower. Today, he'll jump from just 7 metres.
OK, so you're looking straight ahead.
Yep.
Nice big step after three. Here we go. Deep breath.
Yep.
One, two, three, big step.
Geronimo!
David's gusto for going where many fear to tread is impressive.
It's easy.
Leaving one exhilarating leap into the unknown behind him, it's time to return to our high-energy house hunt. For our second proposition, we're leaving Pembrokeshire and heading to the outskirts of the town of Newcastle Emlyn, which sits on the Carmarthenshire and Ceredigion border. Potential guests staying with David and Miranda here would have a short 5-minute drive to the attractive village of Kenarth, renowned for its series of spectacular waterfalls and pools on the River Tavy. Visitors also come to witness salmon leaping upstream here in the autumn. Throughout the year, the settlement has a range of facilities for both visitors and local residents, including two pubs and a traditional tea room. 5 miles away, on the Ceredigion side of the border, is where we find our second house.
Now then, if you come and stop here, I think is the best vantage point. Take in this property.
Well, I'm speechless, actually. No, it looks really lovely.
It does look lovely.
Huge.
We're up on a hillside, and this house, standing proud, overlooks some fantastic landscape.
Yeah, I think anyone coming to visit would be very impressed.
Right, enough of this standing around, gawping at this massive house. Shall we have a look inside?
Yes, please.
Yes, please.
The earliest part of this building dates back to 1634. And although the home was extended back in 2005, we are heading to the older section to soak up some of that original history.
Wow.
Oh, yeah, this is more like it.
That's lovely.
This has got a bit of everything, this kitchen, hasn't it?
This is a bit of us, definitely.
Yeah.
I can imagine cooking there while some of your guests are here and you can still have that interaction with them.
I like all of it. I like the units. It's looking really interesting. This is lovely.
Yeah, I can't wait to see some more.
This is the 17th century part of the property.
All right.
Let me just show you something they've done since buying this place. Let me just squeeze through the middle there.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
This property is concealing some secrets, which we will come to shortly. In the main house, as well as the kitchen, the ground floor also offers a study and WC. The present owners extended the house, adding a boot room and large living room, which may be newer but still retains a sense of the past with those character features.
Ah, oh. Nice space, isn't it?
Yes,
yeah.
Definitely.
So you like what you see?
Yes, lovely.
Yeah, very much.
Yeah.
Now, there's so much to have a look at, we'll have to get a rig along.
Okay.
Come with me.
Accommodation-wise, on the first floor of the main house are 4 bedrooms, 2 light and airy doubles, a good size single, and a master benefiting from an ensuite shower room. They all take in the fine surrounding countryside views. Back on the ground floor, a separate entrance leads to one of 2 self-contained holiday lets.
Now, this is a cupboard with a difference.
Wow.
It opens up to a new world.
Wow.
And this should shed some light on their business ambitions.
Now, you may not have been expecting this room.
That's amazing.
My word.
Now, I don't know what you'd use this room for.
I'd grow tomatoes in here and aubergines.
I'd be tempted to put a proper roof on it.
Whoa. Spoil sport. What are you talking about, man? Look at it. This is like being in Spain.
It's like living in a greenhouse.
It's the Costa del Wales here. Think of this as a holiday home. Suddenly, people could have this as their living space, and it feels completely different.
I've never seen anything
like it. I think it's lovely.
You're going to love this.
My word.
It's lovely. It's very spacious.
It's a massive room.
Mm.
Yeah.
With a wonderful ensuite at the end.
Lovely.
And a dressing room to the side.
Mm. Yeah, really special. I love all these old beams.
Because it's so quirky, that's the holiday that market,
yeah,
isn't
definitely.
It?
Yeah, definitely.
Would you come on holiday to a place like this? That's the big acid test.
I would.
Yeah, I think so.
If it was dog friendly.
Yeah, why not?
And that's down to us.
Yeah.
This is a truly unique property, so I hope that Miranda and David can see the full potential on offer here. Outside should seal the deal, as there's far more than just a modest home for Rufus the horse.
Now here, I think you don't just get a couple of stables, you get the potential for a whole livery yard.
It's lovely.
One, two, isn't it? Three.
Yeah. We'll buy it.
Oh! In this block, you've got seven.
Right.
And then within that building, you've got four loose boxes in there.
Ooh.
What are you doing to me, Johnny?
You've got a business here, or maybe you've got people coming away with their horse, hacking out around this beautiful countryside, around the bridle path, which there are many, and then staying in this quirky cottage.
Brilliant, thank
Let's
you.
Let's go and have a look at some land. Oh, don't say thank you, I've not bought it yet.
Oh.
Of course, this equestrian gold mine has swung it for Miranda, and I'm sure David's brewing ambitions are catered for too. As we make our way across the hillsides, our couple must be dying to know if all this comes within their desired price tag.
Get a load of that.
My goodness.
That is fantastic.
Look at those hills.
As it stands, the house comes with 4 acres. This 8 acres is available additionally.
Okay.
And can be bought from the same owner at the same time.
Okay.
People would go absolutely crazy to open the zip in the morning and look at that view.
Glamping pods would be ideal.
I want you to guess the price of the house and this field.
Given everything that you said, I think we'll have to get a small mortgage. I would think about £900,000.
I'm going to go for £875,000.
Well, this place is on the market at £714,000.
Really?
Ooh.
714?
Yeah. The house with its 4 acres is on at £650,000, and this 8-acre field is on the market for £64,000.
Okay.
This is far more what we're about,
I think it's a bit more our cup of tea, isn't it?
You know what? Walk the land. Get a feel for this place. Take some time here.
Spot.
I'm not going to get bored looking at this. All right? See you in a bit.
Then find some wine.
I don't think there's any vineyards down there. I've really enjoyed showing them this house. Not just because it's a beautiful house, but every step we took throughout the building and around the land, it was a step closer to what I think they're trying to achieve. I could really see them as a couple living and enjoying living here.
At a total of £714,000, this home takes our couple over their mortgage-free budget. But the whole package would give them a 4-bedroom character farmhouse along with a unique 1-bedroom annex. All told, they'd have 12 acres of land plus stabling and outbuildings.
I just thought it was amazing. When we walked into the kitchen first, I just felt like I'd come home almost. It felt like I belonged here.
It was surprise after surprise. It built upon the excitement, really. It really gives you a sense that you could just move straight in.
Well, that's all today. Hopefully, lots to talk about over dinner tonight.
Yes. Definitely.
Yes.
Yes, thank you.
It's day two of our house hunt, helping Miranda and David boldly go from Broadstairs on the east coast of Kent all the way across to the western reaches of Wales. Armed with their budget of £650,000, they're looking for a home that can accommodate themselves, holidaymakers and horses. Up next, we have a slight change to our normal routine.
The birds are singing, no other noises.
We're not going to be looking around the mystery house.
And later, I'll be getting an insight into the making of one of the nation's favourite fashion items.
Now, I've normally asked for a go at this, but I'd rather keep my mitts away from that. That looks absolutely terrifying. Well, after the success of house number 2 yesterday, it's clear we've got a firm contender in the bag. So I'm confident we can take a bit of a gamble today. Now, if you remember, Dave and Miranda said they'd be happy to consider a project. And they'll certainly be getting that with today's mystery offering. I use that term offering because, well, you can't really call it the mystery house. And you'll see why later.
Our final property port of call takes us back to the outskirts of Newcastle Emlyn. But this time we're heading to the Carmarthenshire side of the border. With pubs and a variety of independent shops on offer, the town is an ideal place for those looking to break into the tourism industry. The town's 13th century stone castle was destroyed during the 1645 English Civil War, and today just the walls and gatehouse still stand. Sat in the bend of the River Tavy on a hillside overlooking the town, these atmospheric ruins are the perfect place to take in everything that Newcastle Emlyn has to offer.
It's famous for a beautiful ruined castle and a wonderful River Tavy that runs through it. Apparently, if you believe in such things, this is where the last dragon was killed as well.
Oh, it's fantastic.
Stunning.
I love it.
Stunning views. Just stunning.
Let's see what we think of the Mystery House itself, shall we?
It's lovely.
David and Miranda said they weren't afraid of a bit of work, but it's fair to say our mystery offering goes way beyond the realms of a simple project. These two have worn their ambition on their sleeve so far, but it remains to be seen if they're bold enough to take this on.
The Mystery House.
It's lovely.
There's lots to it. Lots of different pockets.
We're not going to be looking around the Mystery House. Oh. We're going to be looking around the Mystery Hamlet.
That's fantastic.
There's four houses here to look around.
That's amazing.
This is going to challenge you, first of all, just to make decisions.
OK.
Which, when, how.
Right.
So I'm going to take you now into the place I think you could move straight into.
OK.
With minimum effort.
OK.
Which one do you think that might be?
That one.
No, this one.
Our couple were after space for all their aspiring plans, but here they have not just one, but four separate properties, all of which require some degree of development. To get the ball rolling, we're starting with the Welsh Longhouse. Of the four, it's the best presented, but is also the oldest of the cluster. Inside, there's one bedroom tucked into the roof space, looking down on the open-plan living area below.
Oh, I like this. Nice wood burner, nice exposed beams.
The owner reckons it might date back as far as the 11th century. Mm. I mean, this would be just a superb holiday let.
Yeah, I agree.
But bear in mind, we've got the best part of a hamlet to have a look at.
Yeah.
Let's go to one other property, shall we?
OK, yes, yeah, please, okay, yeah.
So that's one down, three more to go. Our next stop is a two-bedroom cottage in a former stable block. Full of original features, including exposed timber beams in the master bedroom and an original bluestone tiled floor downstairs, which is an eye-catching feature.
So, home number two.
Look at the floor.
Now, this is very much the holiday home.
Yeah.
The quirky place, isn't it?
Yeah. I certainly wouldn't want to change that floor. I think that's great.
Oh, God, no.
Just have to get a good hoover. That'd be all right.
Dave's job. Well, the first two buildings we've seen in, you know, these are very palatable, aren't they? You can see how these would work for you. And I'm going to push you further and further the more we walk around this
okay.
whole plot, if you like.
Crank it up.
Crank it up, you say?
Yep, come on then.
Right. Careful what you wish for.
The next cottage is where the real work starts. It has an open-plan living area and four bedrooms, which are in need of redecorating.
It's nice and light. I really like it, but I can see there's some tidying up to do.
Yeah, I think there's quite a lot of work to do. Quite a lot.
There's time to be spent in this place.
Mm.
And money.
But you can see through that, can't you?
Look.
I can see the potential.
We've chosen this as a mystery house, not just because there's lots of property here. It's also got that overused word in property, potential.
Mm. Yeah.
But that's what you're looking for, specifically. Mm.
Yeah, it's got something very special about it. Whether it's too much remains to be seen.
This is the gamble for me.
Mm. I think it's really exciting.
He doesn't quite agree with you there. I think you've got a few alarm bells ringing away here.
We're focusing our mystery tour on four potential residential properties. But there are even more buildings to explore, including a large barn ideal for Miranda's horse and stone outbuildings that could host David's microbrewery. The final cottage has two bedrooms, a characterful living space, a modern kitchen and a south-facing garden with amazing views.
Wow. Spot on. Yep. Look out the window in the morning. Horse is all right. Go back to bed.
This house, houses, hamlet, comes with 12 acres of land. How are you going to put a price on this?
Where'd you begin?
So I think I'm going to go £700,000.
I'm going to go £730,000.
Good guess. This place, amazingly, is on the market for offers around £695,000.
Ooh.
And it will be all involving.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. I'm glad I brought you here, though, because it's brought out some amazing thoughts here, hasn't it?
Undoubtedly, yeah. You can't look at a property like this without even considering it.
I love it. I think I'm definitely in with my heart. But that's probably because I've never had to do any work, really, on a house.
Well, I'll tell you what, there'll be no hiding from hard graft in this place. Now, have a good look around. Just try and see as much of it as possible, and I'll meet you whenever you're done, all right?
OK, thank you very much.
See you
very much.
Good luck.
Thank you.
At £695,000, our mystery hamlet of four Welsh cottages is full of history and development potential. Set in 12 acres, there's also a large barn, stone stable block, and views of the Teivi Valley.
You know what I'd do with this?
What?
Turn it into the brewery and the micro pub.
Oh, yeah. You'll need a drink after all that work.
So as a mystery house, this is just something else, isn't it? Because it's not just one house, it's a whole hamlet.
The mystery house is definitely the best for me. The work doesn't put me off. I can see that I'm ruled by my heart. My husband, however, I think, took a deep breath. I really love it, and I'd move in here tomorrow.
Well, you've surprised me all week. Tell me, which house would you move into first, if you were to?
Here on this plot, or...?
Yeah.
That little cottage,
little
actually.
Cottage.
Oh,
where
really?
She's living.
Yeah, yeah.
I've got it right at long last.
Yeah.
But I don't think you'd have much time for brewing beer for a couple of years, would you? You'd be busy here.
Yes, we'd be very busy.
I'm not sure I'd want to be in your shoes at the moment with all the decisions you've got to make, but let's find you somewhere to have a bit of a chit-chat, shall we?
Yes, please.
Lovely.
Come on. Across the centuries, textile manufacture has been a key industry in Wales. By the mid-19th century, the centre of this Welsh industry was in Ceredigion. Woolen mills lined the edge of the River Teivi, which flows out to Cardigan Bay. Typically, people may think of wools and flannels, but for 40 years in the second half of the 20th century, Ceredigion was home to the UK's biggest manufacturer of jeans, turning out some 35,000 pairs a week. In 2002, the factory closed and 10% of the local population found themselves out of work. That's until David Hyatt, who hails from the Welsh Valleys, came up with a plan to resurrect the skill set and heritage woven into this area. David, great to see you today. Thanks for having
me. Yeah.
Now, looking out over Cardigan, I understand there's quite a heritage here.
Well, it used to have Britain's biggest jeans factory. In this town, everybody's pretty much made jeans at some point in their life.
Wow. You look upon those rooftops, there'll be at least one person that has made a pair of denim jeans. And, it's a big part of your product.
And, skills get handed down.
A lot of people take denim jeans for granted, but there's so much more involved in the process.
But there's 75 different processes to making a jeans.
Look, I'm dying to see how you do this.
Let's go down.
I'm part of the process. Can we go and have a look at the factory?
Yeah.
Great,
yeah.
Thanks.
All the jeans produced here are made from raw denim, which has come straight off the loom and has skipped the washing process, making it more eco-friendly. Claudio Bellotti is a cutter and has been honing his skills over a 50-year career.
Now, the jeans you guys make here, I'm particularly keen on salvaged denim myself. This is the salvage,
then,
yeah?
That's the salvage, yeah.
I love the finish. Yeah, when you first get it, it feels like cardboard,
that's
doesn't
right.
it? And then, over time, it softens up.
Over time, and we initially say you don't wash it for 6 months. You just wear the garment and it takes on the features of the person wearing them. After 6 months, you wash and wear. So it's gone from that to that in 3 years.
The company also drafts in people who break in the jeans for 6 months to achieve a more worn-in look.
But these are like antique furniture, aren't they? They're going to get better as they get older, aren't they?
I mean, better as you wear them.
You're almost creating heirlooms, if that doesn't sound too much.
We provide a premium service and we make jeans that are individual.
How long did it take you to hone your skill? How long was your apprenticeship then?
Ongoing process, ongoing learning. The intention is, because I'm not as young as I used to be, I will train my colleague there to take over doing what I'm doing now.
Great to meet you, Claudio.
Nice to meet you.
All the best.
These highly skilled staff are known here as grandmasters, an appreciative nod to the sheer number of hours they've notched up. It takes around 70 minutes to assemble a finished pair, and I'm meeting grandmaster Amanda Freeman.
Amanda, how are you doing?
Hi.
You also worked at the old factory, is that right?
Yes, I did, yeah. The old factory, we did one job all day long.
What was that job for you?
Inside legs.
But now, you get to do what?
The whole garment from start to finish.
That must be quite satisfying.
Yeah.
You're close to completion on this pair of jeans tonight.
Yeah, I'm just attaching the belt loops at the moment.
Now, I'd normally ask for a go at this, but I'd rather keep my mitts away from that. That looks absolutely terrifying.
Yeah.
I'd like to think that my jeans are part of me, but I think I'd definitely be part of the jeans if I had a go at that.
We average out about 120 pairs a week between the four of us.
See, when you start looking at those numbers, that's not a huge turnover.
No, not in comparison to the old factory, when I used to do, like, say, 1,400 pairs on one job all day.
Wow. Can someone see who's made the jeans?
Yeah, we all sign individually each pair.
Go on then, let me witness this.
So it's GMA for Grandmaster Amanda, and 17 is the year, and then they get their own number.
Have you got a different signature that you sign your cheques with?
Yes. Yeah. that's a birthday card signature.
Perfect. Well, I wish you all the very best of luck. Thanks very much.
The UK jeans industry is expected to grow by 20% over the coming year, and it's been really interesting to see how this corner of rural Wales is once again playing a part in that success. But now it's time to get the outcome of our house hunt sewn up.
Well, for me, I think it's between two properties. House number two, maybe the safe bet, and the mystery house, or mystery houses. Bags of potential, but maybe too much. Let's find out their thoughts.
So, do you want to buy a house or a hamlet?
A hamlet.
I knew you'd say that.
Well, I reckon it's between the last two properties. House number two. We finished yesterday and it felt like that was a definite contender.
We've actually booked a second viewing tomorrow for it.
Mm. Get in.
We want to spend a bit more time walking the perimeters to see exactly how the land lies for the maybe the glamping pods and access.
So the viewing tomorrow, good, 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 good. What about the mystery house then?
Well, I think we're going to come back there as well. We're coming back to Wales. We've had it planned for a while next month, and then we make a decision. That's the time we might make an offer, I think.
Yeah, I'd really like to see it. Well, I'd probably buy it now, actually, to be honest.
Well, it sounds like there's some big decisions to be made.
I never thought we'd have two to juggle. At best, I was hoping for one.
I wish you the best of luck. Whatever you decide, do please let us know, won't you?
We will.
Love to.
Yeah.
Thanks very much for your help.
Pleasure. I can't wait to find out what you decide on. Good
Thank
luck.
Thank you so much.
Well, it's no surprise that they're going for a second viewing at house number two. Let's face it, they loved it at the time, and it gives them pretty much everything they said thereafter. But it's interesting also to note that they haven't completely written off the mystery property. I think Miranda would buy it tomorrow, as she said, but Dave fully appreciates that it is a huge undertaking. So, I wish them both the very best of luck at their second viewing at house two, but I'll also be awaiting eagerly to find out exactly what they decide to do. See you next time.
If you would like to escape to the country in Wales, Scotland, Northern Ireland or England and need our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.